Thank you very much, Samir. So today I want to get back to the conjecture on split values of polynomials. And today I want to tell you how there's a third point of view how you can try to attack this via sieve method. So I want to first state a conjecture again, now a slightly different form, a little bit adapted towards then a result that I want to talk about today. First, a reminder of a problem that we ran into in this type of vibration theorems. So we had some number field, say little k, and then we had a system of polynomials in one variable. We called that p1 of t up to, say, pn of t, its coefficients in k. We assume that they are pairwise distinct. That they are all irreducible and monic. And then let's take some finite extension of k. It was enough for this to be Galois in the last lecture. Now I just want to have a finite extension here. And then we had some finite set of places. Of little k, and that we were thinking about as sort of exceptional places, so places where something is ramified or some coefficients of the polynomials maybe. And then what we wanted to produce, we wanted to produce a value of t0 in the number field little k, such that on the one hand we have some local approximation properties. So that's more or less sort of weak approximation statements for this element t0 at places in S. We want to have some approximation. And the sort of for us now important point is we want that if you take some finite place in K, V, and if the valuation of one of these polynomials at a point t0 is positive, so for some one of these polynomials in our list, and V not in S, so it's not an exceptional place. Then last time I was writing, because we have had a Galois extension, that I then want that the prime corresponding to V is completely split in L. I mean, now it's not Galois anymore, so now I want to replace this with saying that the field extension has a prime of degree 1 above V, then L has a place of degree 1. Above L. By that I mean that there is some prime ideal in L. Yes, thank you. Then L and V. No, L has a place of degree 1 above. Thank you. Yeah, thanks. So by that I mean that there's some prime ideal in L which is unramified and such that a residue degree is 1. So that's the conjecture we discussed, well, already a lot the last 2 days. But we mainly discussed it for linear polynomials. We always assumed all of the polynomials Pi are all linear. And today I want to talk about the very few situations that we know something about a conjecture for not linear cases. So I want to make a remark that a conjecture holds if you have one linear and one quadratic polynomial. So this conjecture holds for, say, P1 quadratic and P2 linear and the ground field little k being the rational numbers. And that's a result which I was proving together with Tim Browning maybe 2016 around that time. So there is something known, and that's using some type of sieve methods, also this approach here. I don't want to talk about this result, I want to talk about another result, which is the only other case, more or less, that we have, which is about one cubic and one linear polynomial. And that's a result which is due to Alistair Irving. So it's called as a theorem. In his result, also again, you're going to use some sieve methods, and they are mainly developed for now, say, over the rational numbers. Or at least it's only proved this result over the rational numbers. And then he proves the conjecture in the following situation. Let P1 of t be a cubic polynomial. And say P2 of t equal to t after a linear change of variables. We can change any linear polynomial to t. That's allowed in this setting. So this is not really a loss of generality. And then we need to make a couple of assumptions such that take a prime number, which is at least 7. And then I want to write a capital K for the field extension, which is Q adjoint T, modulo this polynomial P1 of T, our cubic polynomial. That was called little K1 in an earlier version. So this P1, that gives us a cubic extension. And then we have some prime number. And then we want that, first of all, that K has a unique real place. That is not going to be so important for us. I want to state it now actually in the true form, because I want to call it a theorem here. So I want to put an assumption, but this is not a main focus for us. So assume that K has a unique real place, and we want that K does not embed into the field Q adjoint theta Q, where theta Q is a Q suit of unity. And then take, for this finite extension L, you take Q adjoint 2 to the Q suit of 2. And then the conjecture holds for this situation. So it holds for P1 a cubic polynomial, P2 being equal to 2, where this cubic polynomial has this property that you have your prime Q such that K is, well, not containing Q theta Q, and for this extension L. So then the conjecture holds. So it is a reason, I mean, why you don't want Q to be a subfield of Q adjoint theta Q has to do with the splitting of the polynomial P1 of T in this extension Q adjoint 2, 1 over Q. But this is not so important. So the main point I want to make is so they have one cubic polynomial, a linear polynomial, and then this field extension, and then you can show the split values conjecture. So that's the statement of this theorem. In a way, I mean, it's more specialized than this, all the other results that I told you about. I mean, now we, for example, have to fix this field L to something relatively special. And previously, L could just be anything. We didn't care about what Galois extension it was. But this is sort of the only case that we know where you can, can actually attack a cubic and a linear polynomial. And actually, this leads us to a nice sieve problem. So that's why I chose this example. As we did yesterday, you can reduce this to some problem of counting some, to a counting problem and first dehomogenizing this problem. So this can be reduced. To the following problem. So you want to find a value t such that P1 and P2 are both sort of composed of split values. So again, say we set t equals to maybe a divided by b, where a and b are integers, maybe b not equal to 0. Then the condition 2 for the polynomial P1 would mean that a has to be composed of split values, of primes which have which have some place which of degree one above them. And I wanted to homogenize the cubic polynomial. So let, say, f of ab be equal to constant times b cubed times the polynomial p1 at this point t a divided by b. And this comes to the denominator b cubed. So this is b cubed times p1 of ab is a polynomial in a and b of degree 3. And if I multiply with a suitable constant, then this is going to be an integer coefficient polynomial. Let f be this. So I assume that this is an integer polynomial now of degree 3 in ab. So for c and z chosen sufficiently, suitably. So I just clear with this constant the denominators. Then my f is the dehomogenization of the thing. And now what we want is the following. So say p1, I want this to be a set of some exceptional primes. That's maybe the primes which are in S that we want to approximate something. So for example, they include everything what is ramified in one of the field extension have written down or some coefficients of polynomials. So containing primes that ramify to Q. And then the remark is, if you work in this field extension Q to Q's root of 2, then we know that certain primes have a place of degree 1 in this field extension, namely primes which are not congruent 1 modulo Q. So the remark here is, if you don't have an exceptional prime, and if your prime is not congruent 1 modulo Q, then I claim that this prime has a prime ideal of degree 1 above it in the field extension L. Well, what happens then? Well, then then the equation x to the power q is congruent 2, or is equal to, has a solution in fp. And p not being congruent 1 modulo q, I mean, q was a prime number, so if I say that p is not congruent 1 modulo q, it means that q can't divide p minus 1. I mean, this is a the multiplicative group is cyclic of order p minus 1, so taking a q's power is just an isomorphism, so this thing has a solution. And but this tells us then by sort of, yeah, whatever, algebraic number theory, that the prime p has a place of degree 1 in this field extension. So then, so p has a prime of degree 1, above it in Q, Q, 1 over Q. So why is this interesting? Well, if we ask for split values of these polynomials, then we realize that every prime which is not exceptional and which is not congruent to 1 modulo Q, all of these primes are okay, because they all have this nice splitting property. So you could say, okay, what we now want is we want now to produce numbers A and B such that both A and f of ab are only composed of primes which are not congruent 1 modulo q. And then we would be done. And so that is the goal. So the goal would be to find infinitely many. I mean, one would already be enough, but I mean, again, we are going to do some counting. So we will actually aim for infinitely many values, a, b, say, in the natural numbers, such that some congruence condition holds. So there's still this weak approximation condition somewhere in the background that we need to approximate t. So in brackets I put, we wanted something, maybe a is congruent to a0 modulo m, and b is congruent to, say, b0 modulo m for some m, a suitable m. That's what we would catch the information for the congruences with. But forgetting about that for now, do we find a's and b's? such that a times f of ab is not divisible by a prime p, which is exceptional, so which is not in p1, such that p is congruent to 1 modulo q. So until now, nothing really has happened, but I formulated this in a different way than before. I mean, the last two days, we had this auxiliary variety when we're counting points. Now this is a more hands-on approach. I directly take my polynomials, and even I just want to force them to only take split values in this way. Before I now go on to explain how this can be handled with a sieve, I want to point out a corollary out of this work. From Alistair, which says that if sort of k and q as above, so all everything in the polynomials as above, and then you can show the Hassel principle for a certain variety, which I just want to write down. So I need to define a norm form as yesterday, set omega 1 up to omega q be an integral basis. So basis for the ring of integers of the field Q, Q's root of 2. And then we can define again our norm form. Say norm form of X, this is the norm from Q, this field extension down to Q, of a vector sum of Xi omega I, where X is a vector for a q-dimensional vector now. So I've seen this norm form now a couple of times. I think about this Xi sort of as integers maybe, and this is my element in the field extension L. And then the statement is, then the following variety satisfies the Hassel principle. It looks a bit like an example we had seen in Cyril's talk and also what we did here together earlier. If you take this cubic polynomial P of t equals norm of x, say the part where this is not zero, this satisfies the Hassel principle. This is a corollary which comes more or less out of these type of vibration theorems that we have seen. That was our original motivation why we ended up with this conjecture on split values of polynomials. We wanted to show maybe that the Pramanian obstruction is the only one for nice spaces which come with a vibration to P1. Here the vibration would go down to the variable t, and above each t you have as a fiber torus under norm. Homogeneous space on a non-torus. And actually this field extension Q to Q's root of 2 over Q, this satisfies the Hassel norm principle. So all of the fibers are fine, and so this the whole space will satisfy the Hassel principle. This is just to give you an application of where sort of in practice then this comes in. Good. So now I want to now get back to this problem of wanting to make A times F of AB not being divisible by primes which are congruent 1 modulo Q. I want to formulate this as a sieve problem because that's now the third line of attack that I want to present, and I just want to give you the formulation first. So formulation as a sieve problem. That's actually the line of attack that is used here. So we define now a sequence of real numbers. Call them A, little a n. This A has nothing to do with the other A, so it comes with an index n. A n, real numbers. And here I want to collect how often is n equal to A times F of AB, where A and B range over a certain domain. So we again have to make something, a finite problem out of that. I mean, now there's infinity choice for A and B. And we make this now finite and just truncating little a and b to some interval. And then we said little a n, the sum of all a's and b's are all natural numbers between 1 and n, say. And this capital N is now a new parameter. That's sort of the same that we had t, the parameter yesterday. I want to let this go to infinity later on, this n. And then we count how often is a times f of a b equal to n. Maybe before I dig into this, I could say there's many very different versions of a sieve. So I'm now presenting one to you, which is applied here, but there's also very other forms of sieves. Okay, but so what is a n counts? You can see it as sort of counting with multiplicity how often is n equal to a times f of a b. And we would now like to produce n's for which this thing is not divisible by primes 1 mod q. That's the goal to do. And sieve, why do we sieve? Well, we now want to throw out those n's which are divisible by some prime 1 mod q. That's why a sieve comes in. And the primes which are bad, which we don't want to have, that's a collection which I want to call curly p. Curly p is sort of the bad primes that we want, need to throw away from this n's. So that's a set of all primes, which are not exceptional because we don't care about exceptional ones. But so bad one means being congruent 1 modulo q. Now this is still an infinite set, and that's also I want to make this thing finite. But now let's think for a moment, if little a and b range up to capital N, then there cannot be arbitrary large prime factors in a times f of a b. So we need to think about how large can be a prime factor at all b. Well, it cannot be larger than the size of f of a b on this domain. So that's why we define a quantity, say, called y, which is the maximum of all a b's ranging in these intervals between 1 and n of the function f of a b. And f, this is a cubic polynomial in a and b. So if I range with a b between 1 and n, then I should expect this behaves like a constant times n cubed, say, for a constant positive. And now I define a number which is composed of all bad prime numbers that we want to throw away. And I give this thing a name. I define now capital P of set. Set is now a newer parameter that can be anything. So define for some positive number, real number set, P of set. That's actually a standard notation for sieve. So. For P of set, we take the product of all primes which we need to throw away, so p in this curly p, and which are smaller than z. And now we have the following goal. Now we want to find n's such that little n is co-prime with this product for z being equal to I. So now we define, the goal is the following. We now want to give a lower bound for that's now called a sifting function. And the sifting function is typically denoted at S of curly A. That stands for the sequence of ANs that I start with, comma Y. And Y means that I need to throw away primes up to size Y. And this thing is defined as a sum of all the ANs, but only over those ANs such that the greatest common divisor of little n with P of Y is equal to 1. So why is this the object that we are interested in? So if we have some number little n, being co-prime with p of y means that you are not divisible by any prime which is smaller than y and which is bad. And that means that your product a times f of a b is not divisible by a bad prime at all. And this y is exactly constructed in a way that if you are divisible by a prime, it's anyway smaller than y. So you can think of this, you're just not divisible by any bad prime. Yeah, so if we can show that this thing, say, for capital N goes to infinity, if this thing goes to infinity, then we have produced infinitely many A's and B's such that we have split values. So this is going to be the goal now. And now I formulated everything in a way already that is, looks like a typical sieve problem. And now I want to tell you a little bit about how a sieve works. And for that, I want to move to a more general setting. It looks exactly the same, but except that ANs can be now anything. And then I want to tell you a little bit about how this type of sieve works. So, more general setup. Of a typical SIF problem. So now we take some sequence A's of AM's, could be the one as above, but could also be something else, and the AN's are real. I want them to be non-negative numbers, and say this is a finite sequence, so and as above, there's some cutoff parameter where they all get are going to zero at some point. And P is some set of primes. For us, that was these bad primes congruent 1 mod Q. But you don't need to specify that. And this notation P of Z, capital P of Z, is again the product of all small primes, which are bad. So it's a product of primes in P, which are smaller than Z. And then, in very generally, one defines the sifting function exactly the same way. So then one wants to understand a sifting function S of n z, which is a sum over all n, a n, such that n is co-prime with p of z. I want to make an example of what you can of things that you can all formulate as a SIF problem. I mean, when you think about a SIF, then maybe first you think about you want to find prime numbers, sort of the way that maybe in primary school you would want to find prime numbers, then you take numbers until 100, then you cross out numbers which have divisible by 2 and divisible by 3 and 5 and so on. This is actually very close to the SIF that we are doing here. And so the example that would correspond to this type of SIF of just finding prime numbers, say, is this example 1. It's going to be for us a guiding example. Then you would take an equal to 1. So you would just take all integers up to a certain bound, say n smaller than x, could be 100 for you. And then you take z, the square root of x, and p, the set of all primes. And in this example, the sifting function of a comma z. Well, what is this? Now, this is now all numbers up to x, which are not divisible by a prime which is smaller than square root of x. So that's essentially all prime numbers up to x. So it's a number of prime numbers up to x. I don't know if this notation is standard. So this is number of primes less than or equal x, plus an error term. Well, you made maybe a mistake by primes which are smaller than square root of x. But apart from that, the sifting function detects exactly all primes which are between square root of x and x. And if you want, you can also formulate counting twin primes as such a SIF problem, if you feel like. So how does one attack this sifting function? Well, you have here this condition that n and that p of z are co-prime. So we need an indicator for detecting when is n co-prime to p of z. And for that, we're going to use the Möbius function, which I want to introduce this as a lemma. So we need an indicator for an indicator function for the question when is the n co-prime with p of z. So let mu be the Möbius function. That is, so mu of n is equal to minus 1 to the power l if n is a product of l different primes and 0 otherwise. And then we have the following lemma. For any natural number n, if you take the sum of Möbius of all divisors of n, then you get 1 if n is equal to 1 or 0 otherwise. So if n is larger than 1. So I don't know how familiar this is. You can show it. I mean, if you want to just sort of make a sanity check, then this is something reasonable I've written down. Say if n is equal to a prime, if I look at a sum of d divides a prime, mu of d, a prime has two divisors, 1 and p, so I would get mu of 1, which is 1, plus mu of p, which is equal to minus 1. So okay, this goes fine. You can do this as an exercise if you want. And so this is the indicator function that we use to detect this condition if the greatest common divisor of n and p of z is equal to 1. So I take now this indicator function and stick it into the sifting function. So hence the sifting function s of a and z, this is equal to the sum of all little n's of a n. And now we need to know, is n coprime with p of z? So we need to know, is this number equal to 1, this greatest common divisor? So I can detect this by asking, is d divides the greatest common divisor of n and p of z? This is equal to 1. Now we can exchange the summation. I have now a sum over divisors inside. So d needs to divide the greatest common divisor, so d needs to divide the n, and d divides p of z. So I take outside, say, a summation of divisors of p of z, and then I have the Möbius function of d, and inside I get a sum over n's of a n, such that d divides n. I just interchange the two summations, and now I want to give this object here a name. I want to call this a sub d. This is now not the sum over all a n's, this is the sum over all a n's where n is divisible by d. So I can now rewrite the sifting function as this is equal to a sum of all divisors of p of z of Möbius of d times a d, where a d is the number of a n's, of the sum of a n's where n is divisible by d. And well, actually, now you see kind of how this comes from the sift that I tried to explain in the beginning, sort of with the prime numbers. But this is nothing else than an inclusion-exclusion principle that I've written down on the board now. And so I mean, you can sort of write this as if this is first of all everything a1, and then you subtract, if d is a prime, so a prime smaller than z, you will subtract all the a of p's. And if you're divisible by two primes, so you have to add them in again, so it's sum of p not equal to q, say both smaller than z, of APQ, and so on. So this is a naive approach to inclusion-exclusion and gives you a sieve. The idea is that if we try to apply a sieve, then we hope that we understand the sequence AN to an extent that we can compute these A sub Ds relatively well. So in our example, in example one, so now we need to estimate how large are the a sub d's. In example one, a sub d is equal to the sum of all n up to x, which d divides n, 1, so it's all numbers divisible by d up to x. So this is x divided by d plus bigger of 1. X, this is the total number of things that we count, and 1 over d I want to read as a proportion of those which are divisible by d. In general, we assume that there is some multiplicative function which models sort of the proportion that is divisible by d. So in general, we want to assume the following. So in general, you assume that this ad, which is sum of all our an's, where d divides n, you want that this is equal to some function g, which depends on d, times capital X plus some error term r sub d. So these things are not well defined. I mean, in application, you will figure out we expect this is g or g and so on. So it's not a deficiency. We assume we can put it into this form such that this capital X, that's we think of as a good approximation of a sub 1. So this is a good approximation of the sum over all a n's. And then you read this g of d as the proportion or the probability that you're divisible by d out of this sequence a n's. Now this g of d, we assume that this thing is a multiplicative function. Why would we like to have a multiplicative function there? Now, the idea is that, okay, I can first write this down. Where g of d is a multiplicative function. Which means that g of, if you have two numbers, d1, d2, which are co-prime, is equal to g of d1 times g of d2 for lattice common divisor of d1 and d2 is equal to 1. We want this thing to be multiplicative because you want to think of these events being divisible by d1 and d2 if they are co-prime as independent events. So you can think of this g of d being the probability that if you are in your sequence an, you're divisible by d. So if you have two primes, then you want this to be independent. That's why we say it's multiplicative. And furthermore, we want to assume that this g model sort of a proportion. So I want that on a prime number, this g of p is always between 0 and 1. I'm making now a point of saying that we assume that these events are independent. We will, in a moment, see that it's not always true. It's an assumption that we make, but we will see that it will cause problems for us later, but still, it's what normally you do if you apply it. And we assume that this proportion, expectation that you're divisible by p is between 0 and 1. Normally, you exclude 1 because if g of p is equal to 1, then everything would be divisible by p, and then you would throw away everything. So I want to exclude that for now. Okay, so if we assume that we can approximate a number of things divisible by d with this nice function, then we can rewrite our sifting function in the following way. So then we would obtain that S of a set is equal to, I now stick in this definition for a d, that's this capital X times g of d, so I get a sum over all d dividing p of set. Möbius function of d times the multiplicative function g of d. And then we get an error term, which has the form d divides p of set, mu of d times r sub d, where r sub d was this error term. Now we make use of the fact that g of d is a multiplicative function in this thing here. If g of d is a multiplicative function, then I can factor this product, this sum into a product. So I can rewrite this as, this is then the same thing as capital X times a product over all primes, which are dividing p of set. But p of set is just exactly the primes which are smaller than set and which we want to throw away, the bad primes of 1 minus g of p. Plus the error term, I don't do anything to this, just write it down here again. D divides p of set. If you take this product and you multiply terms out, then you will see that you get g evaluated at a product of primes, where all the primes are smaller than set and p, so this is all divisors of p of set. And the number of minus signs is the number of primes that you have, so this is the Möbius function at d. So you can just reformulate that. But why do we do that? Well, I mean, this gives us a nice interpretation. So I was talking about this g of p as the probability that an element in your sequence an is divisible by p. So then you could say, okay, sort of this 1 minus g of p is the probability that you're not divisible by p. So again, for proportion of probability that some an is not divisible by p. So let's remember what was this S of a set counting. Well, this S of a set was counting all a sub n's such that n is not divisible by a bad prime. Now you can say, heuristically, what do you expect? You would expect that this is equal to everything times the probabilities for each bad prime that you're not divisible by that bad prime. This is again the assumption that these things would be independent.
There's a probability that n is not divisible.
Oh, thank you, yes. Thanks. So that's what this modeling is saying. So now I want to go back to example one and make a point of warning that this looks all very nice and very convincing, but in fact this term which I've written down here may give you the wrong main term. this is not a true answer to the sieve problem. So let's look at this, just to see what limitations of what we now did are. Maybe I can do this. So, a warning. The term x times this product of these bad primes smaller than z, 1 minus g of p, may not be the right error term, not be the right main term. And that we look at in example one, because in example one, we already know what the answer is. We are counting primes. And we know by the prime number theorem how many primes there are up to x. So we can now try again with our nice sieve heuristic what this will tell us about the number of primes. And everything that we are doing now, of course, is quite a bit more complicated if you go back to this original example, but in spirit, that's also how this is working. You apply actually that type of sieve. Okay, so example one. In example one, we had taken all of an equal to 1. We had taken z, the square root of x, and p was all primes. And so we have already computed that is a sub d thing is equal to x divided by d plus big O of 1. That's our error term. So here we would set this multiplicative function g of d would be equal to 1 over d. It's exactly what he had, sort of what the probability, I mean, the proportion of numbers which divided by p is 1 over p. And this r sub d, say, are all bounded by 1. And then this s of a set is equal to capital X is little x, and then we get a product over all primes, which are smaller than z of 1 minus 1 over p, that's g of p, plus an error term. And this is now an object that we know how large this thing is. By Mertens theorem, one has the right answer for this product of primes smaller than z of 1 minus 1 over p. So now you would use Mertens' theorem, which tells you that a product of all primes smaller than z of 1 minus 1 over p, this is for z going to infinity equal to e to the power minus gamma, where this is the Euler gamma constant times 1 divided by logarithm of z. So if we stick that into our sifting function, we would deduce that s of a comma z behaves like 2 times, z is the square root of x, so I get a factor of 2 out here, 2 times e to the power minus gamma times x divided by logarithm of x plus an error term. And now we have a bit of a problem because now you can compute what this constant is, 2 times e to the power minus gamma, where gamma is something like 0.577. But the point is sort of this product here is approximately 1.12 and so on. And that's problematic because we know by the prime number theorem that I should be x divided by logarithm of x primes up to size x, not 1.12 x divided by logarithm of x primes. So we miss the main term by a constant. We do not get a right answer for this. Now you can ask sort of what is the problem here. There's of course several problems. I mean, first of all, you deduce if we get the wrong answer, it means the error terms is just too large. We can't control them. I mean, one point where you should notice that the error terms may be far too large is each of these RODs we can bound by 1 more or less. So if you think about trying to bound this error term up there, P of z has really many divisors. I mean, something like 2 to the number of primes smaller than z divisors. So this grows like 2 to the power z divided by log z. this goes exponentially almost in terms of x, whereas our main term is of size x. And so you want to add up almost exponentially many terms of size maybe one, or you don't know how to bound them better. Well, this may go wrong. I mean, another explanation is that we assumed that these independent events, if you're divisible by a prime, is independent, but they are not as well. I mean, take some number which is, say, divisible by two primes, p1 and p2, which are of size square root of x, and take another prime, p3, which is size square root of x, well, then you're not divisible by all three of them. So there's also an independence problem. Okay, but so this is, this tells us that sort of the way I've written it down naively is nice, but it does not quite work. What is happening in practice is one doesn't try to get it right asymptotic, but only upper and lower bounds. So you would like to replace this indicator function, which just produces too many terms, with some upper and lower bounds. So the idea to fix I will just say what the idea is. I will not go much into that. You will replace the sum of mu of d dividing n, say, by upper and lower bounds . So you want to construct something similar, but the issue here was that these divisors, they can be anything, so we got too many error terms. But now you say, okay, I want to approximate from above and below my indicator function by some sum which looks similar. It's also a convolution, but it may not be Möbius function, but some other coefficients, lambda d plus and d divide n, lambda d minus. You want that this holds for all natural numbers. And now you assume that lambda d minus and lambda d plus, or the sieve weights would call them, they are all supported on numbers little d, which are bounded by some capital D. So you, if this little d is bounded by capital D, then you if you would play now the same game, then you would only get error terms where this little d is bounded above by capital D. I don't want to go into how to construct this. There's a whole theory. I mean, there's lots of work behind that, a whole book, or several books behind that. But I want to point out maybe how a typical theorem then looks like, or how a typical, if you would open our book about sieves, I want to tell you sort of what does it look like. And maybe we have time to apply it to an example, or I can give you that as an exercise. This is lambda d minus and lambda d plus. They are supported on numbers which are above bounded by d. So, okay. Now, for this, I need a little bit of notation. So now I want to explain you sort of, how does a typical theorem look like if you open a book about sieves and maybe how to apply this thing. So the standard notation would be, we would call this product of these 1 minus g of p, we want to call it v of z. So we can set v of z equal to the product of p smaller than z, p a bad prime, 1 minus g of p. So in many applications, it turns out that this v of z grows like some power of a logarithm of z. This was the case for us here in counting primes. This v of z by Merton's theorem goes like 1 over logarithm of z. And because this happens in many applications that you have such a type of growth, we make out of this an assumption. And we assume that this v of z has some sort of logarithmic growth in log z. So in many applications, there exists a constant, call it kappa, and a constant k, such that, now, if I want to be correct, I don't need to talk about v of z, but I need to talk about the product where we start at some parameter W and look at all primes which are between W and Z, which are bad. And so if you want, take W just equal to 2 for now. And then very often this is bounded by a constant times the logarithm of Z divided by the logarithm of W to the power kappa. I took here a minus 1, so this 1 over log Z will become then a logarithm of Z over here. So if you want take W to be equal to 2, then you say this is growing like logarithm of Z to the power kappa. And I want to call this condition star because it's often satisfied, and then we would call kappa the fifth dimension. So the dimension of this sieving for primes would be equal to 1. And furthermore, for and this parameter d larger than 1, this is this new cutoff parameter that we introduced with the sieve weights. That's where the little d's can live that we consider. For this, we want to define a sum of error terms. We want to set r of d is equal to the sum of all error terms, little r sub d, where d is bounded by capital D, and say d divides p of z. And if these sieve weights lambda d are supported on numbers which are no larger than capital D, then we will only encounter error terms where this little d is bounded by capital D. And this makes this error term actually handleable. Because if I don't have this condition, well, then we would get in this prime counting sum exponential growth almost. But if you say you can force this d to be a power of x, then you can imagine, you can say something meaningful about that. And handling this error term, so that would be the level of distribution, as you call it, that's a central input in this work of Alistair Irving, where he understands how to handle this for cubic polynomials. So this is something for higher degree polynomials, you wouldn't know how to do it anymore. So now I maybe want to state a typical theorem, what it looks like. If you ever want to apply a sieve, I mean, one really standard reference is a book called Opera de Cripro by Friedlander and Irvanets. And you will see many, many different formulations of this type of theorems. I now just take one which is a bit easy to formulate, which is not exactly optimal. I will write it down in a moment. Yeah, I first need to make some space. I'll write this down. But I try to warn you that a theorem that I now write down is correct, but it's not the best optimal one. So if you dig a bit deeper into the book, you'll find better versions. I don't want to introduce even more notations. So the reference that you can look into would be a book is called Opera de Cripro. And it's written by Friedlander and Irvanets. So if you open that book, then you will somewhere find a theorem which has something shape of the Wallin form. You assume that this d, this is the cutoff for your sieve weights, and set our parameters, and assume that star holds. Assume that this v of z behaves like a bunch of logarithms to the sieve dimensions. Then you can approximate the sifting function that would be for us, for example, here the number of primes of Z would be square root of X, or the thing that we are interested in, the numbers which are not and not divisible by primes smaller than Z, which is bad. Then you can approximate this, the approximation that we figured out that we think should be this capital X times V of Z. That was our main term over here. And well, we don't expect this is an extremely good approximation. I mean, even in counting primes, we saw they are off by a constant, but maybe the constant is not too small, not too large. So there is a constant which explicitly now is something like 4 times 9 times the sieve dimension plus 1 to the power kappa. If you want, I will say something about constant. There's an e to the power minus s, that's important, times k to the power 11 times x times v of z, plus the error terms r of d. So it is bounded by the expected size. In front of it, a constant, which if s gets relatively large, I'm saying in a moment what s is, the constant gets small. And here, where s is equal to the logarithm of d divided by the logarithm of z. So how does this help? Well, first of all, you can produce upper bounds on this sieve function. And you can also produce lower bounds on it if you make sure that your r of d is sufficiently small, and if you make s large enough such that maybe this constant is smaller than a half. So you could hope for a situation maybe that, that this thing is smaller than a half, and the error term is small, then you would actually produce a lower bound for this thing here. And that you can typically achieve if sort of, I mean, s being large means if you have a fixed d, that's just, yeah, d will be maybe fixed because you need to control these error terms up to d, so d may be some power of x. And then in order to make s large, you can make z small. I mean, the smaller you make z, the larger your s gets. So this will tell us we can sieve up to a certain number of primes away. The set, this tells you, the set is the sort of the level what primes can we throw away. So this type of theorem will tell you for a certain constellation, if you have some d, then you can find, if you take z small enough, some small enough power, you can actually get a lower bound for this s of a set. I want now to illustrate this theorem, just take, show you a little bit how it works, and bound the number of twin primes above. This is a nice application, maybe. Of course, we don't get a lower bound, but we can get an upper bound from this. So let's call this example two. I mean, yeah, I will just show a couple of steps in there. I mean, if you want, you can think about this, yeah, as an exercise or something that you can actually produce with this thing. It's not twin primes, but with such a theorem, you can produce numbers m such that m and m plus 2 are both composed of not too many prime numbers. So this may be a nice exercise if you want to think about producing such numbers. Okay, but so a twin primes would be, could be formulated as sieve of the following form. We would take a n equal to 1 if n is equal to m. This is one way to formulate it. There are other ways as well. M times m plus 2 for some natural number which is bounded above by x and 0 otherwise. And then let's say we take for z square root of x. And if we now look at numbers little m such that m times m plus 2 is not divisible by a prime which is at most square root of x, then if m is larger than square root of x, it means that both m and m plus 2 have to be prime. So then, so P is the set of all primes. Then this S of A comma Z, this is then counting all m's up to x such that neither m nor m plus 2 have a common divisor with one of the small primes. So this is the number of twin primes plus maybe bigger of square root of x. So the next question would be, what is this function g of d? With the total number of things that we count is x, so this would be our capital X. And so say A1 is then x. And A sub d, the number of terms which are divisible by d, the sum of m up to x such that d divides the product of m and m plus 2. How do you calculate this thing? Well, you would sort your numbers m into residue classes modulo d. And now write it down a bit more general because this is exactly the same thing that you could do with our starting sequence a n if you want to compute this function g of d. So in general, you would say, okay, we take a sum of, say, maybe m zeros modulo d, such that m0 times m0 plus 2 is congruent to 0 modulo d, and then we count all m's up to x, such that m is congruent to this m0 modulo d. And this inner thing, this is again x divided by d. We affix one congruence class modulo d plus an error term, which is at most 1. So the sum in total is going to be x divided by d times the number of solutions of this thing modulo d, so it's times the number of m's modulo d, such that m times m plus 2 is congruent 0 modulo d, plus an error term r sub d. Now let's call this function which counts how often this is 0 modulo d. Let's count this, call this rho of d. Rho of d is not hard to determine. And for a typical prime, there's exactly two residue classes that allow, that you're not allowed, except for d equals 1. And then this error term rd is bounded by this rho of d, which is the number of things in the sum here. So it's bounded by, say, rho of d. And set now the multiplicative function g of p is equal to, if you take a prime which is larger than 2, then now two classes are forbidden. Because neither m not be 0 and not be minus 2 modulo p. So g of p would be 2 divided by p. If p is larger than 2, a prime, and g of 2 is equal to a half. If p, well, for p equals 2. And these functions g of p will also detect if you try to do something impossible locally. So if I wanted to make, say, m and m plus 1 prime, they can't be both prime because one of them is always even, infinitely often. But if you want to ask for that condition, then this function g would say at a point 2 would say equal to 1. And that would mean that you throw out everything. If g of 2 is equal to 1, then this function v of z x is equal to 0, and then your main term is going to be equal to 0. So in that sense, this function g of p detect locally if things are. This is a local statement if things is possible. But this is our nice multiplicative function. We throw away two classes, because neither m nor m plus 2 are divisible by d. And then you can bound this error term r of d. It is now bounded above by a sum d up to capital D of this function, how rho of d is bounded by a divisor function, tau of d, d divided by p of z. And the sum of a divisor function up to d grows like d times logarithm of d. And v of z, this is now a sieve of dimension 2, is equal to a half. That's from the prime 2, a product over all primes between 2 and z. Now we have 1 minus 2 divided by p. And this grows for z going to infinity like the logarithm of z to the power minus 2. Now we get a power minus 2 because, I mean, from Merton's theorem, you know that a product of 1 minus 1 over p grows like logarithm z to the power minus 1. And if you would square this thing and calculate what you get, you will see that 1 minus 2 over p will behave like this. So I don't do this calculation for now. So that if, because of this 2, you would say the sieve dimension kappa is equal to 2. And that corresponds to we have thrown away two residue classes for every prime. There's two classes which are forbidden if you want to have m and m plus 2 prime. So now, set d, something like maybe x to the power 1 minus epsilon, for some epsilon larger than 0. We do that because the main term that we expect is now of size x divided by logarithm of z to the power 2. So if I take dx to the power 1 minus epsilon, then the sum of these error terms will be certainly smaller than the main term. But this is fine. And then we can now apply the theorem. So then we apply the theorem, and then we get that s of a comma z is bounded above by both the term that we compare it with and everything what is on the right-hand side, But everything is now bounded by x divided by logarithm of x squared. Because v of z is of size 1 over logarithm z, and z is square root of x, so this behaves like x divided by logarithm of x squared, and the error term is smaller than that. And that's a very nice result, because it tells us the expected upper bound for the number of twin primes. From this we deduce, because twin primes, if they are between square root of an x and x, they are counted by our sifting function as of z. So in particular, we can bound the number of m up to x such that both m and m plus 2 are prime. We can bound this by x divided by logarithm of x squared. Well, as I said, this is the expectation. We actually also know what constant to expect here. Why should we see this the right answer? Well, the prime number theorem tells you that up to size x, there are x divided by logarithm of x primes. And now we don't want to make m prime, but also m plus 2 prime. So 1 over logarithm of x, you can see as the probability that a number is prime. And now you want to make m and m plus 2 prime. So the probability, if it's independent or both prime, should be logarithm of x squared. And that's the answer that we see here. So this is sort of to demonstrate you how such a sieve can work. Actually, it's relatively close to what Irving does in our problem of producing split values of polynomials. There's a few steps in between. You first have to reduce this. You do one inclusion-exclusion step explicitly, what is called bootstrap identity. But then, in principle, you actually apply this type of sieve or a slight refinement of it. And all these steps that we did now, sort of calculating the level of distribution, takes a lot of work. It's done explicitly. This calculation that I did very long, I did it because this is exactly how you would kind of find a multiplicative function for our original problem. So this is actually relatively close. Okay, so I think that's enough for today, or for this week, I guess. I hope that I could give you a little bit of an impression sort of how you can formulate a problem and roughly sort of what the ideas are about. So thanks for all your patience, and thank you.